In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, last week we celebrated the joy of Christ's resurrection. But Easter Day is so big it lasts for 8 days, and the Easter season for 50. And so today I say to you again, Christos Anesti.
Anesthetos Anesti.
Christus resurrexit.
Resurrexit ver.
Christ is risen.
Truly he is risen.
It's been a strange Easter, our joy marred by separation, our celebration muted by pandemic. In our gospel today, we'll see that in the first Easter week, the apostles were also anxious and incredulous. Even the first Easter wasn't all chocolate bunnies. We continue to pray in this Mass for all affected by the pandemic, for the dead and grieving, sick and anxious, elderly and vulnerable, for health professionals and scientists, workers and those out of work, leaders and health authorities, for our loved ones and each other. Though we cannot gather for Mass, we are trying to make our homes true domestic churches, schools of faith and powerhouses of prayer. That we might, with Christ on this Easter day, rise out of the tombs of our sins, let us repent and ask him for new life. Lord Jesus, you have revealed yourself as the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You have poured out on your people the Spirit of truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are the Good Shepherd leading us to eternal life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Oh,
Let us pray. God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast kindle the faith of the people you have made your own, increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose Spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The whole community remained faithful to the teaching of the apostles, to the brotherhood, to the breaking of bread, and to the prayers. The many miracles and signs worked through the apostles made a deep impression on everyone. The faithful all lived together and owned everything in common. They sold their goods and possessions and shared out the proceeds among themselves according to what each one needed. They went as a body to the temple every day, but met in their houses for the breaking of bread. They shared their food gladly and generously. They praised God and were looked up to by everyone. Day by day, the Lord added to their community those destined to be saved. The word of the Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy has given us a new birth as his sons, by raising Jesus Christ from the dead, so that we can have a sure hope and the promise of an inheritance that can never be spoilt or soiled and never fade away. because it is being kept for you in the heavens. Through your faith, God's power will guard you until the salvation which had been prepared is revealed at the end of time. This is a cause of great joy for you, even though you may, for a short time, have to bear being plagued by all sorts of trials, so that, when Jesus Christ is revealed, your faith will have been tested and proved like gold. Only it is more precious than gold, which is corruptible, even though it bears testing by fire. And then you will have praise and glory and honor. You did not see him, yet you love him. And still, without seeing him, you are already filled with a joy so glorious that it cannot be described, because you believe. And you are sure of the end to which your faith looks forward, that is, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the evening of that same day, the first day of the week, the doors were closed in the room where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them. He said to them, "Peace be with you," and showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. And he said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so am I sending you. After saying these words, he breathed on them and said, Receive the Holy Spirit. For those whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. For those whose sins you have retained, they are retained. Thomas, called the twin, who was one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. When the disciples said, We have seen the Lord, he answered, Unless I see the holes that the nails made in his hands, and put my finger into the holes they made, and unless I can put my hand into his side, I refuse to believe. 8 days later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. The doors were closed, but Jesus came in and stood among them. Peace be with you, he said. Then he spoke to Thomas, Put your finger here. Look, here are my hands. Give me your hand. Put it into my side. Doubt no longer, but believe. Thomas replied, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, You believe because you can see me. Happy are those who have not seen and yet believe. There were many other signs that Jesus worked and the disciples saw, but they are not recorded in this book. These are recorded so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing this, you may have life through his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
Painted for the Marchese Vincenzo Giussiani at the beginning of the 17th century. The incredulity of St. Thomas was the most copied of all Caravaggio's paintings in its day. It now hangs in the Sanssouci Picture Gallery, not in southern Sydney, but in Potsdam, Germany. At Easter, Thomas missed the Lord's appearance to the others and dismissed it as wishful thinking. Unless I see the holes of the nails made in his hands and put my finger there, and unless I can put my hand into his side, I refuse to believe, Thomas said. Now on Low Sunday, it's Thomas's turn to encounter the risen Lord. Caravaggio has Jesus pulling open his white robe and guiding Thomas's wrist towards the wound in his side. The hands becoming a new lance so that we can look upon the one they have pierced. Thomas puts his finger in the hole, while two other apostles and we look on. It's a fascinating and intimate scene, not least because the artist eschews all surroundings, using only theatrical light and darkness to draw our eyes to what matters most. Here we see empirical man demanding proof and persuasion, and an indulgent rather than reproachful of God, eliciting faith in something greater. All three apostles seem to be looking beyond Christ's wounds to something else, to Thomas's declaration, "My Lord and my God." A recent critic punned that Caravaggio's painting is one of the most famous pokes in art history, and sympathized with Thomas, who's only remembered for his incredulity. Maybe there's more going on here this morning than a hard-hearted materialist demanding evidence and being scolded for it. First, when Jesus meets his friends on Easter Day, he shows them all his hands and side. So Thomas wasn't being especially obtuse, or Jesus being especially critical. No, what Thomas wanted to verify was this: not just that Jesus was alive, but that it was really Jesus who was alive. Thomas had already seen Jesus' power over death. He didn't need to be persuaded of that. Why he wanted to be sure was that this was neither fantasy nor ghost. The ancients believed a soul could wander the earth or the underworld separated from its body. But Thomas knew that that would be no true human person. No, we are bodily beings. If this is really Jesus who is risen, Thomas knows it must be the bodily Jesus, however strangely new that body may be. Here Jesus teaches, and Thomas grasps a crucial part of our Christian faith: that the resurrection isn't about some new us, it's about making us new, better, best. Thomas's inquiry is about identity and continuity, and Jesus' answer is that there is no rupture between the I of this world and the I of the resurrection. But hold on. Jesus ends with the last and greatest of his beatitudes: "Happy are those who have not seen and yet believe." So should Thomas have asked his questions and demanded his proofs? Or should he have stopped all the questions and just believed? Both, of course. Jesus is man, and so we can see and touch him, be inspired by his teaching, impressed by his actions. But Jesus is more than a great man, a revolutionary teacher, a spiritual guru. He is the revelation and power of the unseen God. Thomas sees the man and professes the God. He is an example of an integrated intelligence, of perception, imagination, and memory working together to grasp reality. A man of both faith and reason. Seeing is believing, in the sense that it often precedes and prompts our understanding. But believing is seeing also, seeing more deeply, beyond the obvious and the comfortable. On the 13th of August, 1967, at St. Michael's Lane Cove, Monsignor Hughie Maguire gave me my first Holy Communion. Sister Mary Eucharia, a Sister of Mercy and my Year 2 teacher, prepared me for the sacrament, teaching me in simple terms that this was the bodily Jesus, but also the spiritual God. She thought it would help us to grasp this if we said Thomas's words, "My Lord and my God," at the consecration. And more than five decades later, I'm still doing so. What might all this say to us in a time when in St. Peter's today, as St. Peter says today, we are plagued by all sorts of trials? His thought in his epistle is that this is a test of our mettle. And undoubtedly, our character and ideals are being tried right now. Peter challenges us to demonstrate more than ordinary human virtue. Christians under pressure must reflect not only Jesus, the perfect human being, but also the supernatural faith and hope from Jesus, who is God. If that is true of individual believers in times of trial, it should also be true of the Christian community. So our first reading challenges the church to be faithful to the apostolic teaching if it is to draw more people day by day, to be faithful to the fraternity between its members so that they share ever more gladly and generously. Above all, to be faithful to the breaking of the bread and the Eucharistic prayers. If you can't celebrate the Eucharist in the temple, the Acts of the Apostles suggest, do so at home. Or by live streaming, you can do both. Happily, we are seeing such natural and supernatural virtue, such human and divine qualities in spades amongst our people at present. They are finding new ways to share their faith and ideals, to connect with and look after each other, to share and pray. With Thomas and Caravaggio, with Sister Mary Eucharia and the First Communion Class of 1967, we can say, even from our TV rooms, when we see the elevated host, "My Lord and my God." And from the host, he says back to us, "Blessed are you who have not seen and yet believe." Let us profess together our faith in the one who rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the apostles, the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The risen Christ brought his peace to the apostles as he showed them his pierced hands and side. Let us pray confidently in his name, knowing that he brings true peace through his victory over death.
That all the baptized would remain faithful to the teaching of Christ, handed on to us in the Church by the apostles and their successors. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
That all would look to the divine mercy of God, turn away from sin, repent and accept God's love and forgiveness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
That the peace of the risen Lord may spread through our world today and strengthen Christians to recommit their lives to Christ and to serve generously in his Catholic Church. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That doubtful Christians would recognize and worship Jesus in the Eucharist and proclaim with St. Thomas, my Lord and my God. Let us pray to the Lord. That all people would be protected and freed from the COVID-19 pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the faithful departed would enter the sure hope and promise of their heavenly inheritance, especially those who have died alone due to the current pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. As we reconsecrate our nation to Our Lady of Good Health, we pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Eternal God, in whom mercy is endless and the treasury of your compassion inexhaustible, look kindly upon us and increase your mercy in us, that in difficult moments we might not despair nor become despondent, but with great confidence submit ourselves to your holy will, which is love and mercy itself. Amen.
Thank you. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day above all, to laud you yet more gloriously. When Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death. And by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy.
Most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, Terry and Richard, my assistant bishops, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for those to whom you've been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bowed on for the blessing.
May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance. And may you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God,
the Father,
the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass has ended. Hallelujah.
I don't think there's a key there.
Come on. Just one. Just one. Thank you, Your Grace. Thank you, Father Lee. I was wondering what you were going to say. I don't. Oh, okay.